Welcome to Real World Peaceful Parenting, a podcast for parents that are tired of yelling, threatening, and punishing their kids. Join mom and master certified parent coach Lisa Smith as she gives you actionable step-by-step strategies that'll help you transform your household from chaos to cooperation. Let's dive in.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome to today's episode. Oof, we are in for a treat today. I am so excited. I always get really, really, really excited when I have the opportunity to interview someone, and today is no different. I woke up at 5 o'clock this morning, ready to go, because today I get to talk with and to introduce you all to Gail Sundell. Gail is an artist, a beautiful, wonderful, amazing artist. She's a lay minister. She is a mother to two amazing adult children and a grandmother to three strong-willed kids. And Gail is part of my Hive membership, Gail and her daughter. And Gail is a beautiful example, beautiful example. I mean, it chokes me up to even think about the beautiful example that she is of a grandparent supporting their grandchildren, strong-willed grandchildren, and a mother supporting her daughter as she navigates parenting strong-willed kids. And Gail and her daughter learn alongside each other. They support each other. And I wanted all of us to be able to hear a conversation of what it's like for a mother to support her adult daughter and her grandchildren in their strong-willedness as they find their journey to peaceful parenting. So welcome, Gail. I'm so happy to have you here today.
I'm so pleased to be here. Thank you.
Wonderful. Yeah. Gail is just, oh, I just love you. So let's start out, ease our way into this conversation with, let me ask you, how did you find me and this work? And tell us the story of how we arrived at this place.
About 2 or 2.5 years ago, I was just perusing Facebook and I saw the peaceful parenting advertisement. I can't even remember how it was presented, but it was the angry parent and an offer to download the book, the angry parent. And so I did, and I read it. But at that time, of course, it was all new, all the vocabulary, all the verbiage that is a daily in our vernacular now. I mean, we use all these terms and everything, but it resonated with me, but I didn't act on it. The reason why I wanted to download it and look at it is because my daughter has three strong-willed children. I didn't know the terminology at that point, but I just knew that things weren't going well. And I didn't remember screaming at my children, and my children don't remember that I screamed a lot, but my poor daughter was dealing with her children that way. And I just felt so bad for her, and I just couldn't understand why. And so I thought maybe this would help. And I downloaded it for her, and I'm not sure if she got around to reading it or not, but the screaming continued. And it was finally in February of this year that I saw again. Oh, I guess I kept getting those emails from you after I downloaded it. And so it was resonating, it was just in my mind, my subconscious. And I decided, well, you know what? I just spent $260 on horse feed. I also am an avid equestrian and have two horses. And how could I not spend $150 on the peaceful parenting program? And when I'm willing to spend that much on my horses, I mean, these children are so much more important than those horses. And it was so, so worth it. And Amanda, I did it for her. And so I hoped that she would be the one that would be listening to it and gaining from it. And she did as much as she could, but working full time with three children, it's hard to get the time, and the Zooms were when she was at work, so that she was able to listen to the recordings. But anyway, after we finished that, progress was so evident that we decided to join the Hive then. And it is just so worth it. And we appreciate so much the benefits of the peaceful parenting view of life. Grandparenting.
Wonderful. Well, you've both had a really nice transformation. Take us back, Gail. Let's start here. Let's talk about the before and after. So what was it like watching your daughter struggle as a parent and watch the, not only the struggle, but the lack of connection or the less than connection, I shouldn't say lack of, but the struggle even to create the connection between this daughter that you love so much and are close to and her children. As a grandparent, what is that like to stand on the sidelines and watch that?
Oh, it just hurt. It hurt my heart because I knew that wasn't her. She is mm-hmm. such a sweet natured person, mm-hmm. but it was like she was protecting herself. She was dysregulated. Now I know that word, you know, mm-hmm. she was hurting. And I realized she has, well, I don't remember when it was when the light bulb went on, but I realized my daughter is dysregulated just like her children are. And she is lashing out because she is dysregulated. And now I believe that your work is as much self-regulation as it is parenting skills. I mean, it's all about us. It's all about, I can only change myself. Mm-hmm. And she has learned, I mean, she is learning. It's a journey, but she has learned to regulate herself. And she realizes it now, though. She can see that. And she said, this wasn't their issue. This is my issue. and oh my gosh, this morning she said, I just wanted you to know how grateful I am to not be angry all the time. I mean, she didn't realize she was angry all the time. And she was just screaming out of self-defense because they wouldn't listen to her. And yeah. she was just trying to get their attention. She wasn't trying to be mean. It just was, she didn't understand. And she's beginning, I mean, to understand now that, you know, it's up to her and she's doing a wonderful job. Almost every day she has a new story of success. And it's just wonderful.
Yeah, I see this so often where, and certainly this is a part of my story, like your daughter, I was angry all the time. And at first I didn't recognize it, angry and frustrated, mm-hmm. you know, because I wanted it to go one way and it was going a different way. And the more I tried, the louder I yelled, the more angry I got, the more we moved away from the result I was looking for. So of course that's going to create frustration within someone. And I see parents all the time parenting from a place of anger and frustration, and our kids deserve better. You know, that's the bottom line. And when I can help someone enjoy parenting and drop the anger and work on themselves, I just think we're making the world a better place one family at a time. Because the only way our kids are going to learn regulation is if it's modeled in the home.
Yes.
And that's what your family is working on, right? Staying regulated in the face of three strong-willed, determined, not always cooperative, not always compliant young children.
Yes. If I might, this may be a diversion path, but we requested a visit from our oldest grandson, 6 years old, last week for 5 days. And he came and visited, and it was a roller coaster ride. I mean, we had ups and then we had some deep downs. And at one point, we went and got him on Wednesday, and Saturday, my husband had just about enough. He wears hearing aids. And so loud noises really hurt, physically hurt him, hurt his ears. And our grandson is very boisterous and dramatic. And my husband just said, when our grandson, just very loudly, I asked him to do something. No. And he said, what's he going to be like when he's 13 if you can't control him now? And he just left the room. And I just about started crying because this is a journey. But the the conflicts, the challenges are great. And it worried me and worried me and worried me. And the next morning, I woke up and we had a little conversation about some other things. And then he said, how'd you sleep? Because he couldn't sleep all night thinking about these other things. And I said, I couldn't sleep at all because I was worried about riding all night because of what you said. I mean, because it made me worry. I was fearful. And he said, you know what? He said, I realized that violence or spanking is just a shortcut. He said, it gets results immediately, but the collateral damage is great. He said, I mean, bad. I mean, a lot of collateral damage. I mean, these are my words, but this was his message. And he said, I realized that like in politics or the world, war is a shortcut to getting what you want. You just shoot them and then they're gone and you don't have the problem anymore. Well, that's not what we want. We want to be nonviolent parents and grandparents. And he said, I realize it's a journey. So you keep trying, he said. I mean, he was being supportive. He realized that, yes, it's painful. It's challenging. But he gave me such a gift to say, I understand what you're doing. He said, it hurts me too badly. I can't do this, but I can support you in what you're trying to do for our grandchildren. And oh my goodness, that was just so moving. And I realized, yeah, he's so astute. And he parents, grandparents differently from me, but he realizes the value in, you know, diving deeper and connecting. It's just that he doesn't have the skills to do that yet. Neither do I. We're all working on it.
Right. Well, I think that's a beautiful story, and it's a beautiful example of the teamwork. And it's one of the things that impresses me the most, Gail, about your entire family, is you all have locked arms together. Dad, you know, your husband, dad, you, the mom, your daughter, and your grandchildren are all locked together in a circle, figuring out how to get maximum connection and cooperation with these three strong-willed kids in 2021. And I think every adult child in the world would love to have this support. And I talk to grandparents all the time who want to provide this support. This is the level of support that extended family can provide to parents of strong-willed kids. And it's so much more effective than telling them what to do or judging them or doling out dominant parenting advice, right? It's the realization that there's a new way to parent. And nobody wants to listen to a six-year-old boy meltdown, scream, cry. Nobody, you know, it's loud volume is loud volume. And, you know, it's great that your husband can say, that hurts my ears, but I understand why you're doing it and I'm going to support you from afar. That is a level of support that your grandchildren will benefit from. And your support, it's a beautiful family circle, and your grandchildren are going to be better for it. So what I'd love to dig into is talk to us about how you support your daughter and advice you have for other grandparents that want to do it like this, that see the benefit, but don't know how yet.
Maybe by asking questions rather than telling, you should do this or you should do that. And have you ever thought about, or I was, you know, I've been listening to this program and I gained an insight. And would you like to hear what I learned? I'm a younger child. And so I always had the big sister that was my guide. And so I have an easy time not being the dominant one and telling everybody what to do. That's just my nature. So if you're the oldest one and used to being right all the time, it might be a little more difficult, but I'm not always right all the time. So I'm always doubtful, but just suggestions, I guess. And yeah, just not being domineering, I guess.
Not being domineering. I think also I've observed that you are really in tune with what your daughter needs for support and then what your grandkids need for support. And sometimes that's different things.
Yeah.
Right?
That's true. Sometimes it just can't be done. I mean, but you try again or you do a do-over. I love your do-over idea. I had to use that a couple times when grandson one was here. And he says, that's all right. We all make mistakes.
You know? So sweet.
They have taught him, you know.
Yeah.
Also, also have an adopted daughter here in town. And it's a long story, bittersweet story. And she has a 7-year-old, 4-year-old, and 2-year-old. So they're very similar to our other grandchildren. And they call me Grandma Gail and think I'm one of their grandparents. And they are different from the other grandchildren and take different parenting skills. And I don't feel like I have shared as much with my adopted daughter because she's I can't be quite as not forceful, but domineering over, you know, she's
opinionated.
Opinionated. Thank you. She has a mother and a stepmother and a mother-in-law. She has a lot of mothers, but we have such wonderful conversations and I'm sure she's open to it, but the relationship is just a bit different, but I'm encouraging her too, because I'm sharing it with everybody. I hope I am the self-help that makes people more aware is just so valuable, let alone how we're improving our children and our grandchildren's lives.
Mm-hmm.
So valuable. I do appreciate that so much.
Well, thank you. Yes. So the other thing I want to ask you about, Gail, is you mentioned it earlier. Let's talk about this. So your grandchildren come over to your house with their parents or by themselves or collectively they come and stay with you. And you mentioned earlier, you know, as a grandparent, there's value in staying regulated, right? Being another role model. And I think this is probably, if I had to guess, this is something that you've really worked on and seen a lot of growth, is staying regulated when your grandchildren are dysregulated and or their mom is dysregulated. But you as a strong influence in their lives, you working on yourself staying regulated when they're dysregulated. And I think this is something that I want grandparents to hear and parents and adopted parents and foster parents and aunts and uncles and, you know, the opportunity to influence children by staying regulated when they're dysregulated. I think you can see the value in that at this point. Yes?
Oh, definitely. Yes. And it's not only with the children, it's interpersonal. I mean, it's in our marriages and in at work, the workplace. It's just so wonderful to be aware that connection and relationship is essential to make this world run. Mm-hmm. And if we mentor that to our children and grandchildren, they'll see it and they'll internalize it and it will become a part of them.
Yes. And I think someone, you know, the beauty of a grandparent or an aunt or a bonus mom or dad or like you described, an adopted grandparent staying regulated is as a child, this is someone that I look up to. And when they show me regulation, it's just another beautiful relationship and another influence on my life, another person staying regulated when I'm dysregulated as the child, when I'm storming, it deepens the lesson. It's another example. I look up to this person and they're staying regulated. You just can't beat it. I mean, I want everybody to practice regulation around kids. You know, I know even for me, my son is getting ready to start a new high school. And the opportunity for dysregulation right now is there. Mm-hmm. You know, there's excitement, there's worry, there's stress, there's the unknown of the new. Am I going to like it? Is it going to work out? There's the decision of leaving the old high school to switch. There's the missed friends. And that school is starting before the new school, right? So then there's FOMO, fear of missing out, kicking in. There's all these emotions swirling around. And every morning I wake up and I say to myself, regulation, Lisa, you've got to be the model of regulation in the storm, you know, and I really set my intention right now more than ever to make sure that I'm staying as regulated as I possibly can while he's on the roller coaster ride of emotions. Mm-hmm. And I see the influence that this is having. I see when I set my intention and I'm the regulated person, I see that intense energy in our house just going down a level or two, you know? So I'm reminded of the value. When I think about you being a beautiful example to your grandchildren of staying regulated when they're storming, I think what a gift you're giving them. You know, it far exceeds any monetary thing you can buy them. And it, to me, is a real expression of love. I can stay regulated, grandchild or child, when you're struggling. I can be the oak tree in the room.
I was totally aware of that in the last 5 days with our grandchild, and totally failed several times, many times. And I was so glad to have the tools that you've given us to do a do-over and to be able to say, you know, I'm sorry you feel that way, but I'm sure glad I have enough love for the both of us, because I can see how upset you are. There's so many tools that we need. And I was so grateful to have while caring for him last week. I used the namaste quite a bit, just to regulate myself, so my feelings weren't hurt. And so I wasn't fighting back. I was just realizing, oh boy, he's dysregulated. There's something going on. I'm not sure. They're not at the point yet where they really verbalize. They only have one word feelings right now. Mm-hmm. They can't really. I keep guessing and asking them to guess, but they don't really respond yet. But, you know, it's a journey. And
yeah. And, you know, Gail, as we're talking about this, I'm even thinking about your grandson. And, you know, as much as he loves grandma and grandpa, and I'm sure he was so excited to come stay with you for a week and thrilled, there's still, for a little guy, you know, 6-year-old little guy, there's still fear of the unknown and nervousness and a change in routine and maybe missing mom and dad and missing, you know, brother and sister. And so even though it's exciting and he wants to go stay with grandma and grandpa, at his age, he's dealing with a lot of big emotions. And what you gave him is the beautiful gift of, okay, I see you. I see you're struggling. And you resisted the urge to take it personally. How dare he? You know, this is so exciting for him. Why is he behaving like this? Does he know how good he has it? Or I'm working so hard over here to make this a special week for him. You know, you really resisted the urge to take it personally. And you returned to the tool of regulation over and over and over again. And of course, now in retrospect, any of us could hear your story and think, of course, a 6-year-old is going to be dysregulated, leaving his home for a week and going to visit someone else. Of course, that's going to happen. And you just gave him space to work through that while you all were together and gave yourself space to work through it. I love it. I think it's just a beautiful example of what's possible. And, you know, when we're with our grandchildren, if they become dysregulated the first 5 minutes they're at your house, it doesn't mean that we have to have that set the tone, right? We can have a do-over and regulate and start again fresh at any moment. So for those listening, if you hear nothing else out of today's episode, whether we're parents or nannies or grandparents or aunts and uncles, there's always the chance to have a do-over. There's always the chance to start again. And I ask all of us, no matter what age of the kids we're interacting with, raising, loving, don't take it personally. So Gail, I think I'm going to put some words in your mouth as we wrap up here. I think what you're saying is, if you're a grandparent, if you're an aunt and uncle, if you're an adopted grandparent, and this work speaks to you, jump in, dig in, learn, apply, because the connection that happens when you're on the path to peaceful parenting is amazing. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Very well said. Thank you.
Beautiful. Well, thank you for sharing your story and your family with us today. Again, you're just a beautiful role model to grandparents, to parents of adult children that have strong-willed kids. And I really wanted everybody to just have a chance to meet you and hear an example of what's possible. I think that that's just, so what I wanted people to hear today is, it's never too late to jump in the path of peaceful parenting. And if you have kids in your family and you want to learn more, I invite you to come and join our community. And I invite you to learn the tools.
I think that's what I wanted to add was the weekly coaching has been so helpful because I can't remember the words or the phrases or the terminology, but being reminded every week and hearing your advice to the other parents has been so helpful. I love what you said that, you know, reading about it is learning it, but being coached is putting into practice. I don't even know what you said, but it was something like that.
And, yes. Reading is passive learning and coaching is transformation.
Yes. 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 And so thanks. Thanks for being there. It's helpful. I love it. I look forward to both sessions every week.
Yay. That makes me so happy, Gail. That makes me so happy. Well, thank you again. I know on behalf of everybody listening, thank you for being here. Thank you for doing this. It really means a lot to me. And Gail did a great job. She was a little nervous at the beginning, but you did a great job. You shared your story. We got the message across. And I know lots of people listening to this are benefiting from hearing about your experience and the support you provide to your daughter and at the same time, your grandchildren. So I just adore you, Gail. And I'm so grateful that you were here today.
Well, thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Beautiful. Okay, there you have it. There's Gail's story. And if this resonates with you and you think, you know what? I want a story like that. I want to be on Lisa's podcast. Then jump over to thepeacefulparent.com and join us. Okay, until next time, I'm wishing you peaceful parenting.
Thanks for listening to Real World Peaceful Parenting. If you want more info on how you can transform your parenting, visit thepeacefulparent.com. See you soon.